A very good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. The only item of business on our agenda today is the committee's consideration of the Charities Regulations and Administration Scotland Bill at Stage 2. The Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Shirley-Ann Somerville, joins us for this item. The Cabinet Secretary is joined by her officials, but just to make members aware, they cannot take part in the debate and are not named on the record. Everyone should have with them a copy of the bill as introduced, the marshalled list of amendments that was published on the 25th of May, and the groupings of amendments which sets out the amendments in order in which they will be debated. There will be one debate on each group of amendments, and I will call the member who lodged the first amendment in that group to speak to and move that amendment, and to speak to all the other amendments in the group. Members who have not lodged amendments in the group but who wish to speak should indicate that by catching my attention if they are in the room, and for members online by placing an R in the Blue Jeans chat. The debate on the group will be concluded by me inviting the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up. Standing orders give any Scottish Minister a right to speak on any amendment. I will therefore invite the Cabinet Secretary to contribute to the debate just before I move to call the winding up speech. Following debate on each group, I will check whether the member who moved the first amendment in the group wishes to press it to a vote or to withdraw it. If they wish to press ahead, I will put the question on that amendment. If a member wishes to withdraw their amendment after it has been moved, they must seek the committee's agreement to do so. If any committee member objects, the committee immediately moves to the vote on the amendment. If any member does not want to move their amendment, when called, they should say, "Not moved." Please note that any other MSP may move such an amendment. If no one moves the amendment, I will immediately call the next amendment on the marshalled list. Only committee members are allowed to vote. Voting in any division is by show of hands. It is important that members keep their hands clearly raised until the clerk has recorded the vote. So can members joining us online also please make sure their hand is clearly visible on the screen? The convener has a personal vote as a committee member and also a casting vote in the event of a tie. It is entirely a matter for the discretion of me as a convener how to use the casting vote. There are no agreed conventions on this point. However, if the casting vote is used, I intend to indicate the basis on which I will use the casting vote immediately before doing so. The committee is required to indicate formally that it has considered and agreed each section and schedule of the bill, and so I will put a question on each section at the appropriate point. We will now move into consideration of amendments, and if you should refer to your marshalled list as well. So, the question of is section one to be agreed? Are we all agreed? So I'm going to call Amendment 1 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary in a group of its own. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move and to speak to Amendment 1?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Section 2 of the Bill imposes a specific requirement to include the names of charity trustees on the Scottish Charity Register. As well as ensuring transparency and accountability in charities, this section also aims to ensure that publication of information does not put anyone at risk. Where the safety or security of any persons or premises could be jeopardised, an application for dispensation can be made to OSCR to exclude the charity's contract address or any trustee names from the register. A discretionary element was added to the bill to allow OSCAR to apply dispensations to a charity or a class of charities without the need for an application, for example, in the case of a women's refuge charity. However, OSCAR has since expressed some concerns regarding this element of discretion, in particular that it potentially creates an additional burden on OSCAR to look behind every charity entry on the register in order to ascertain whether dispensation should apply. This was not the intention behind the provision. Following discussion with OSCAR, the Government is satisfied that the key policy intention can be achieved in other ways, for example by OSCAR taking the initiative to contact a particular charity or class of charities to discuss any security concerns with them and to invite applications for dispensation that could then be processed swiftly. As such, this amendment adjusts the process to be followed before a dispensation is granted. It removes OSCAR's ability to grant a dispensation of its own accord, whilst retaining the ability to grant dispensation and remove the relevant information following an application from a charity or trustee. Convener, I hope the committee can appreciate the need to overcome this technicality, and I move Amendment 1.
Thank you. Can I ask if any member wishes to comment on the debate? Paul.
Thank you very much, Convener. I've come to this bill without having had all the previous evidence sessions that other committee members have. But I just wonder the rationale in terms of OSCAR, where they might seek to remove someone of their own accord. Would that have been in a case where there may have been a risk to the person who was registered? And just to understand a wee bit more about the government's rationale for bringing this amendment in terms of not having that power. If I may, Convener.
Yes. Would you like to comment, Cabinet Secretary?
Thank you, Convener. It's certainly the ability for us to ensure that we are providing OSCAR with the powers to ensure that they can do what they need to do. For example, as I gave during my introductory remarks around the women's refuge, so if there is a threat to a trustee or that trustee feels that they may be threatened if their information is given, then that information can be withheld. So we are still upholding the transparency aspect, but respecting there may be very specific circumstances and understandable circumstances about why a trustee may not wish their details to be made public. This amendment is simply to ensure that we are still have that policy intent within the bill, but without what OSCAR may perceive as an additional burden.
Paul, do you wish to come back in?
If I could just briefly, Convener, so I'm just trying to understand, this amendment essentially removes OSCAR's unilateral power, if you like, to make a decision to remove someone without their consent, in a sense. I just wonder if there are scenarios where that power would be required. So, for example, where perhaps the individual doesn't see the risk to themselves, but there is maybe a wider risk and taking that action. So I'm just trying to understand what discussion there was with OSCAR in this. I mean, were OSCAR concerned that they would have to require that unilateral power, essentially?
Cabinet Secretary, sorry.
Thanks. So certainly a charity can also apply on behalf of an individual as well. So even if an individual may not wish to or not be in a position to apply, the charity can apply on their behalf. So it's not just down to the individual. So I hope that reassures the member on this. It is about specific concerns that OSCAR has raised around the impact of that discretion to grant dispensations of its own accord, because it is a legal obligation on OSCAR to do so.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Okay. Does any other member wish to contribute to the debate? Okay, that's the case. Then the question is that Amendment 1 be agreed. Sorry, bear with me. So, can the Cabinet Secretary wind up or press or withdraw the amendment?
No further comments. Happy to press the amendment.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So the question is that Amendment 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. The question is that Section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. I call Amendment 21 in the name of Jeremy Balfour and a group on its own. Jeremy, if you want to move and speak to Amendment 21. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning to colleagues. Can I just remind colleagues that I am a member of the Church of Scotland and I am a retired Baptist minister. In regard to this section, this really looks to balance, I think, the two things that we want within the bill. We want a transparency so that the public, people can have confidence to know who are trustees of each charity and to be able to hold them accountable. But at the same time, we want to encourage charities and to be able to flourish and to be able to attract trustees into their charity. And that's a balance that this bill seeks to work its way through, and I think, by and large, it has achieved that, and that's why we are supporting the bill, and I should probably just put on record that we will be supporting the government amendments as we go through them one by one. However, in regard to this particular area, I do think the balance has gone too far away from charities. The issue here is in regard to a process, and these regulations, I think, are disproportionate and hugely costly. We heard in the Stage 1 debate that this could cost over £100,000 for the Church of Scotland to do alone. If those who are on the committee received, I think last night, an email from the Episcopal Church, which gave the example of what they would do, that they have in one diocese, they have 50 church buildings, 40 rectories or manses, 25 church halls, which equals a total of 105 properties. With each congregation having a minimum of 3 associates, the number of registered required would be 5 times 115 times 3, which equals 1,725. That is for one diocese, and then that would have to be times by 7 for the whole of Scotland. That all requires legal work to be done and would require solicitors to be involved every time that happens. Now, already, the Charities Bill creates a public register for charity trustees, so there is no hiding if you are a trustee. But to go through this process is time-consuming and expensive. As a committee over the last number of months, over the last year, we have taken evidence of how hard it is for many people in our society to keep going, that relying on food banks, relying on other areas, and that is often provided by religious bodies. And I suppose the question for the committee today is, would we want to see £100,000 spent on helping people come out of poverty, helping young people, helping children, all the activities that happen day in, day out across the different churches and religious organisations? Or do we want to see that money go into lawyers' hands? And that's why I think this amendment gets the balance right. It means there's accountability, there's openness in regard to who trustees are, but it doesn't mean that we're simply going through a slightly bureaucratic system which will only, as I can see, benefit lawyers. So for that reason, I will be looking to move Amendment 21 in my name, Convener.
OK, thank you, Jeremy. Would any other members wish to come in at this point? Paul?
Thank you very much, Convener. And I think in the Stage 1 debate, I had engaged in this discussion to say that I do share a number of the concerns that are raised by Jeremy Balfour and indeed by a number of the churches. And I think this argument has been well rehearsed in the Chamber and elsewhere. There is a challenge. I think the Government have obviously agreed to a year's kind of grace period of the implementation of the Land Reform Act provisions. But I think there is serious concern that what isn't coming forward is actually any kind of solution to the issue, but rather a pause. So I do think there's a balance here. I think the balance very clearly is about ensuring that we have transparency of who has a controlling interest in land and property. But I think if we can balance that by ensuring that trustees are transparently available via the OSCAR process, then it might be worth looking at the amendment in more detail that's suggested by Jeremy Balfour to remove the burden from churches. I thought it was very start that the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland passed the deliverance at the General Assembly just last week on this. I think we do need to take cognizance of that. I would just be keen to understand in the definition of religious charity that Mr. Balfour has outlined, just is that a legal definition? Is there a legal definition of a religious charity? You know, sort of playing devil's advocate, pardon the pun, but just to understand, could someone, for example, set up a religious charity to try and mask the fact that they own land? Now, I'm not saying that would happen or not, but I'm just trying to understand, do we have a definition of a church or a religious group, or, you know, is it wider than that? Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks, Paul. Would any other member like to come in at this point? Okay, can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to comment? Thanks.
Thank you very much, Convener. And just with respect to the point that has just been raised, my understanding is that there is no definition of religious charities, and that is one of the technical difficulties with this bill. But for that and for other reasons, I cannot support the amendment in the name of Jeremy Balfour. Charities regulation is fundamentally in place to ensure and maintain public trust in the operation of charities. The Register of Persons Holding a Controlled Interest in Land, known as the RCI, was an essential part of the Land Reform Act, which was unanimously passed in 2016. The purpose of the RCI is to improve transparency in relation to land and property assets, irrespective of what type of legal entity owns them, and to ensure there's a direct link between the property and whoever exercises a controlled interest in that property. This bill seeks to increase transparency in relation to charities. So I appreciate that concerns have been raised about the RCI, in particular by the Church of Scotland, and my assumption is that Jeremy Balfour's amendment is in relation to those. However, I must stress that a bill on charity regulation is not the place to try and address those concerns, and would indeed change the obligations of the RCI, which have, as I've already said, been debated in Parliament, not just within the Act, but also within the discussions around the SSI on RCIs. The information that will be available on the Scottish Charity Register under Section 2 of the Bill is a charity trustee name. The RCI relates to transparency in ownership and control of property, and as such requires additional information to simply a list of names. Therefore, the information required is not the same, and the two registers are not like for like. The Scottish Government has had considerable engagement with religious organisations recently, particularly the Church of Scotland, in developing the RCI regulations. To address the concerns of some religious stakeholders, the transitional period before offence provisions take effect for non-compliance was recently extended by 12 months to the 1st of April 2024, with the unanimous support of this Parliament, therefore providing those who need to register with the RCI more time to prepare their submissions. All parties supported the introduction of the RCI, which is a key part of our land reform strategy. Much progress has been made by this Parliament on delivering greater transparency in relation to individuals who have a control over decision-making in relation to land. The RCI regulations are a complex piece of legislation, and this amendment risks unintended consequences to them. I therefore urge the committee not to support this amendment.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I now invite Jeremy Balfour to wind up or press or withdraw Amendment 21?
Thank you, Convener, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and Paul Keane for their contributions. We do already have exceptions in regard to this, as the Cabinet Secretary will be aware. Scottish charitable and corporate organisations are excluded from this, so there are already exceptions that we have agreed on. Picking up Paul Keane's point, I will have to go and check that, and for that reason I won't be moving the amendment, because I would like to clarify that. One of your charitable objectives is the promotion of religion, so I would have thought that would be the fallback scenario to stop anyone having to do that, that to get charitable status you would have to prove to OSCA that you are able to show that you're doing a religious organisation, but I will seek to clarify that before coming to stage three. I do hear what the Cabinet Secretary is saying, but I think we are hearing in regard to the cost of this and the public benefit does seem to me be more on the line of not having to do this, because I just cannot see how it is appropriate. And for some churches, this will be an annual thing that they have to do, because their church secretary, their assessing clerk, will keep changing, and every time that happens, they will have to redo that again. And so I do think the cost of that. However, picking up the points by both other speakers, I would like to reflect on that, convener, and so I will not be moving the amendment today. Okay. So I withdraw the amendment.
You withdraw the amendment, yes. 21. Okay. So, is any other member object? No. Okay. So the question is that sections 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary in a group of its own. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move and speak to Amendment 2?
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 2 addresses the recommendation made by the Committee at Stage 1 to provide for a dispute mechanism in connection with Oscar's appointment of interim trustees. The Committee raised the issue that there was a lack of recourse for any existing charity trustees in a charity where interim trustees are appointed. This amendment addresses that issue by extending the established review and appeal mechanism under the Charities and Trustee Investment Scotland Act 2005 to appointments of interim trustees in cases where it is known that there are still some existing charity trustees continuing to act. The new provision introduced by Section 8 of the Bill is designed primarily to capture those small number of cases where there are no trustees acting for the charity. However, I do accept that there may be some occasions where an existing trustee could still be acting and the right of review over Oscar's decision is warranted. The same is also true of the existing appointment process, which is restated by Section 8 of the Bill. In that scenario, although the aim is that existing trustees would ask Oscar to step in because they are unable to make an appointment themselves, that request does not have to be unanimous. As such, I agree that it is right that there is a review and appeal mechanism for any trustee who wants to challenge that decision. I hope that members will therefore support the amendment, and I move Amendment 2.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Apologies, just moving back to the previous section, the question was, is Sections 3 to 8, and I never picked up on 8 to be agreed. So are we all agreed to Sections 3 to 8 for the record? Thank you. Thank you so much for your forbearance. So can I ask any members if they wish to contribute at this point? Miles?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials. Just to put on the record, welcome this. I think it was one of the key parts of some of our considerations. How it works in practice is something I think we will also want to see monitored. So I hope that will be something the Scottish Government will take forward, but take into account, hopefully, the limited number of cases this will actually be needed for. Thanks.
Thanks, Miles. Does any member wish to come in at this point? No? Cabinet Secretary?
Nothing to add, Convener.
Okay, can I ask you to wind up, press or withdraw the amendment?
I'll press the amendment.
Okay, thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Sections 9 to 11 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Can I call Amendment 3 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with amendments as shown in the grouping? Cabinet Secretary, to move Amendment 3 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, Amendments 3 to 12 refine the records of mergers provision as introduced following discussions with Oscar about how they will work in practice. They do not alter the fundamental intent of the provisions, which is to ensure legacies left to charities in wills are retained for the charity sector and that so-called shell charities do not clog up the register simply for the purposes of collecting legacies. Amendment 3 will provide that a transferee charity has a choice as to whether or not to notify Oscar of the merger rather than being under a duty to do so. Notification of the merger may be done at any time after the transfer of all property rights and liabilities of the transferor is complete. While we would imagine in most cases transferees will want to notify Oscar of a merger, we don't think it needs to be a specific duty. Amendments 4 to 11 would provide that the key date which triggers the rules on redirection of a legacy is the date notice of the merger. The date notice the merger was given to Oscar instead of the date Oscar records the merger. This means there is no risk of a legacy being lost due to a delay in Oscar recording a merger, for example, where a merger is notified just before a bank holiday and then the testator dies during that weekend. Oscar must still keep a record of all charity mergers notified to it, and the record can be used as a reference point to establish what has been notified and when. The amendments will also provide that a transferor charity will not need to have a formally wound up or dissolved in order for the rule redirecting legacies to step in, which should avoid disrupting any winding up processes which the charity may have commenced, having already transferred all its property to another charity. Amendment 4 would also give the Scottish Ministers the power to clarify what is meant by notice being given. In most cases, the giving of a notice will be instantaneous using email or Oscar's online system. However, where notification is sent by post, there may be a need to make specific rules around when a notification of a merger should be treated as being given, for example, where delays occur due to postal strikes. It may transpire that there is not a need to bring forward regulations to clarify this type of point. However, given that Section 12 of the Bill introduces a new process, I want to ensure that any unforeseen issues relating to notification that arise in practice can be swiftly addressed, particularly once Oscar has established a process for dealing with merger notifications. Amendment 12 corrects a referencing error in relation to the definition of a will. And I move Amendment 3.
Thank you. Can I now invite members if they want to contribute to the debate? Miles, thanks.
Thank you, Convener. I welcome these amendments. One of the points of clarification, which I still think maybe is needed and maybe for stage three, is with regards to a charity, which is a UK-wide charity, maybe based in England, which does research funding in Scotland, which might also then, that research project could have a legacy gifted towards it from a Scottish-domiciled individual, and wondered if that had been captured within these amendments for clarification. That's maybe something the Cabinet Secretary wants to go away before stage three, but I know of a number of charities who, for example, fund research projects at our universities, and individuals might donate or leave a legacy to that project. So just wondered, within these amendments, and I wanted to see these brought forward, whether or not that had been captured, or any legal advice on that scenario taken.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. I'm happy to take that away and provide an update to Mr Briggs and the committee, and take back at stage three if we need to do so.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I now invite you to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 3?
It will press, Convener.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
So I call Amendments 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 and 12, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendments 4 to 12 en bloc. And I wish to ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 4 to 12. Okay. Thank you. So the question is that Amendments 4 to 12 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. The question is that Section 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
So I now call Amendment 13 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary in a group of its own. Cabinet Secretary, can I invite you to move and speak to Amendment 13?
Convener, Amendment 13 introduces a new section to the bill, albeit one on a topic that has previously been subject to full public consultation. Amendment 13 seeks to clarify the existing provisions in the 2005 Act relating to the reorganisation of endowments held by what are often referred to for shorthand as statutory charities, that is, charities constituted under a royal charter or warrant or an enactment. An endowment is property where the capital has to be preserved and only the income is spent on the fund's charitable purposes. For most charities, if the charity's constitution would not allow it to take an action such as varying its constitution, transferring its property to another charity or amalgamating with another charity, the charity can apply for a reorganisation scheme to allow it to take that action if granted consent by OSCAR. However, these rules are turned off for statutory charities, subject to a specific exception relating to endowments. The wording of the existing provision has caused confusion for some statutory charities and OSCAR about the extent to which an endowment can be reorganised by OSCAR. In some cases, this has meant the only way forward is through the use of private bills to reorganise endowments. My amendment today is intended to resolve that issue and to allow endowments held by statutory charities to be reorganised, as we believe the 2005 Act always intended. Convener, this is not a straightforward area of the law, and as such I anticipate that there may be a need for some further technical refinement of this section at Stage 3 once detailed feedback from charities, legal professionals and OSCAR has been received. Given the complexity involved, there are also still wider issues around statutory charity reorganisation that would need to be considered in the post-bill review. However, this amendment provides a solution in the short term for some statutory charities that should see significant financial savings by no longer needing to reorganise through a private bill. It is right to deal with fixing the rules around endowments first, as there is a long historical precedent for those being allowed to reorganise more readily, and there is existing provision upon which to build. It was also the current exception relating to endowments, which OSCAR asked us to clarify in its 2018 paper with the proposals, that formed the backbone of this bill. The amendment contains two new regulation-making powers for Scottish ministers. The first is a power to adjust the definition of endowment should practical experience of the new provisions give rise to any issues. The second power gives ministers the ability to disapply through regulation these changes in respect of particular endowments or charities or classes of endowment or charity. This latter aspect is considered necessary in order to ensure that, where there are policy reasons for restricting the reorganisation of a particular endowment or charity, that can be achieved. I hope members will agree with me that we should do what we can now to refine the provision that is already in the 2005 Act on this topic, and then we can turn in the post-bill review to the much wider question of reorganisations which do not involve endowments. I move Amendment 13.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I invite members if they wish to contribute to the debate at this point? Okay. Can I then ask the Cabinet Secretary to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 13?
Press, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 13 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I now call Amendment 14 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 16 and 20. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendments 14 and speak to all amendments in that group?
Convener, this group deals with both notices given by and to OSCAR. I will speak to Amendments 14 and 20 first, which deal with notices given by OSCAR. Amendment 14 makes a minor change where OSCAR is obtaining documents from a third party for an inquiry into a former charity. The amendment clarifies the application of the rule, which ensures that where a body continues to exist but without charitable status, notice is served by OSCAR on the body which used to be a charity. Amendment 20 is designed to provide OSCAR with alternative methods of serving notice in certain circumstances. Convener, as part of its overarching duty to act in a fair, transparent and proportionate way, OSCAR is required to serve notice on a charity or a charity trustee before it can take specified regulatory action, for example, issuing a direction. However, in some cases, OSCAR does not have accurate contact information for the charity or trustees in order to serve the notice, which means that OSCAR is prevented from pursuing regulatory action as it is unable to serve the required notice. While the introduction of an internal schedule of trustee details held by OSCAR will in large part address this problem, there will inevitably be cases where contact information is unavailable or becomes out of date. Amendment 20 will allow OSCR to serve the relevant notices by other means, for example by publishing a notice on its website. Serving notice by other means would be used as a last resort where previous attempts to contact the charity directly had failed. This will then allow OSCR to continue its regulatory action. This amendment only relates to notices where the action being taken is one which it would still be appropriate to take, even if the charity or body in question cannot be contacted directly. For example, this would apply where a direction is issued to a bank not to part with charity funds, but the charity also needs to be notified of the direction. There would be value in issuing that direction to the bank, even if the charity itself cannot be located and could only be notified by means of public notice. Turning now to notices given to OSCR, Amendment 16 addresses concerns raised by stakeholders, particularly the Law Society of Scotland, about the current requirement for charities wishing to take certain actions which require OSCR's consent to give OSCR at least 42 days' advance notice before they take the relevant action. Amendment 16 does not remove the need for charities to obtain OSCR's consent before taking such actions, but it would mean that once OSCR grants its consent, the charity will be able to act straight away if it wishes to, rather than having to wait until the end of the 42-day period. I hope the committee will agree with the approach being taken here in respect of all these notice requirements and will support all the amendments in this group, and I move Amendment 14.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I now invite members if they wish to take part in the debate? No. Can I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 14?
Press, Convener.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
And the question is that Sections 15 and 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
So I now call Amendment 22 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, grouped with Amendment 23. Can I ask Jeremy to move Amendment 22 and speak to both amendments in the group? Thank you,
Convener. Amendment 22, I think, tries to pick up something that came across in the evidence that we took at stage one, and that is in regard to the third sector charities being aware of changes to this bill, if it becomes an act, and what effect it will have on them. There was concern raised, particularly by SCVO, but by other charities, that the communication hadn't quite worked between OSCR and them, and that some charities were unaware of what was proposed in the consultation and in the bill. And there was concern that if this becomes an act, then charities may not be aware. So this puts a bit of pressure, gentle pressure on OSCR to do a bit more perhaps in regard to communication and for Parliament to have the satisfaction and the knowledge that this has happened, and so that the Parliament, or maybe particularly this committee, can review that in 2 years' time. So I hope that is helpful to OSCR, but more importantly, helpful to the third sector. In regard to Section 23, Convener, again, I think one of the striking things that came out in regard to the evidence wasn't what was in the bill, but what was not in the bill. And there was, I think it would be fair to say, disappointment from certain sectors that the bill didn't go further, quicker and faster. Now, I understand we had COVID. I understand that the Cabinet Secretary has a lot on her plate. But I think there is an appetite within civic society generally to see a more radical reform of charity law here in Scotland. I think I'm right in saying that in the Stage 1 debate, the Cabinet Secretary did suggest that there wouldn't be any further legislation in this Parliament, which I, again, understand. But I am concerned that once this bill becomes an act, hopefully before the summer recess, that it goes off our agenda and may go off the Scottish Government's agenda because there's other things going on. So this, again, really is an opportunity for the government to take forward what I know they want to do, but do it within a scale which at least this Parliament can see the direction that the Scottish Government is going on, and then the next Parliament can hopefully take that forward and bring forward more legislation. So it really is kind of an encouragement. It's hopefully a stick and a carrot for the Scottish Government, which I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary would welcome.
Thank you, Jeremy. Can I invite any other members who wish to comment on the debate? Okay. Can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to comment? Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 22 appears to follow on from a recommendation made within the committee Stage 1 report. In my response to that report, I agreed that effective and open communication is vital to ensure smooth implementation. Oscar also wrote to the committee to set out an initial outline for communicating changes to charities and, in addition, confirmed it would share its plan with the committee ahead of engagement with the sector. Amendment 22 focuses on charities with two or fewer employees, but that is 73% of charities. Oscar would be expected to aim its support and guidance at the majority of charities in any event. It also requires communication with each charity. However, at present, it is not possible for Oscar to do this. That is why we have Section 11 of the Bill and Amendment 20 in my name. There are over 25,000 charities, and whilst Oscar have contact details for the majority, communicating with each is not technically possible. However, I am sympathetic to what Mr Balfour is trying to achieve and would be happy to work with him on a Stage 3 amendment that would enhance Oscar's existing reporting requirements, and I would therefore urge him not to press Amendment 22. Turning to Amendment 23, this would require ministers to carry out a review of the act that this bill becomes, starting 6 months after royal assent, and lay a report before the Parliament no later than the 31st of December 2025. Convener, we do not expect the Act to be brought into force 6 months after royal assent, so there would be no experience of the Act in practice at that point, and also an adequate amount of time is needed for an Act to actually embed so that evidence for a review can be gathered. Certainly.
Great for Cameron Shirley. I appreciate the comment she has made. Would the Cabinet Secretary be open to negotiation at Stage 3 in regard to perhaps a later date in regard to that? So the principle is that there would be a review taking place before this Parliament finishes in just on 3 years' time. So is the principle there, or, and if that, would she be open to some discussions before Stage 3 in regard to dates?
Thanks, Kevin. I would be open to that. However, I'm not sure it would actually have the desired effect that Mr Balfour would want. And the reason I say that is, if we did agree to amendments to the timescales of any review that fitted better with the commencement plans, it would be necessary to divert resources from the wider review that we have already said as a government that we will undertake once this bill is enacted. We would be obliged to carry out a review, even if nobody was calling for it or had any issues in practice. And I don't believe that's the right approach, particularly when any stakeholders who might want to raise specific points relating to the bill will be engaging with the wider review that we have committed to, and will therefore no doubt raise any points that they would ask us to consider. So for that reason, I'm afraid no, Mr Balfour. I would not be too open to that. I do try to oblige Mr Balfour with amendments and assist, but not in this case. Convener, as set out to the committee previously, the Scottish Government intends to take a phased approach to implementation, with at least two sets of commencement regulations anticipated to be in spring 2024 and summer 2025. This is to allow charities and Oscar the time needed to prepare for the changes and give Oscar the opportunity to consult with the sector, produce guidance and communicate the changes. The Parliament has the ability to conduct post-legislative scrutiny of any act, and therefore it is not necessary for this to be specified within the bill, particularly those timings do not allow with the expected commencement of the bill. As I've already mentioned, Convener, the Government is committed to conducting a much wider review of charity regulation following commencement of this bill, and my officials are already preparing the groundwork for that, and indeed I have carried out meetings on this issue as well. I'm committed to working with the sector to shape that review and ensure that there is a proper opportunity for engagement. I know that members and stakeholders were very clear during stage one of the importance of this, and I very much agree with that. A review of this current bill, as I've said to Mr Balfour, would hold up that wider review by diverting resources. And I would therefore urge the committee not to agree to this amendment if Mr Balfour presses it.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I now invite Jeremy to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 22?
I'm grateful for the Cabinet Secretary's remarks around Section 22 and in light of her offer to work for something perhaps better for Stage 3, I will not be moving Section 22 and withdraw that.
Okay, so we can just seek to withdraw Amendment number 23. Do any other members... Does any other members object?
No.
Okay, thank you. The question is that Amendment 22... Sorry, my apologies. Can I now call Amendment 23 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with 22. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Can we just a point of order? Do we not have to go back and move the amendment? Before? We haven't moved every other amendment yet, have we?
You withdrew the amendment?
Yeah, so I was 22. 14, 16 and 20 have maybe moved yet.
Just pause that for a minute, thanks.
Do you want to suspend for 2 minutes?
Can I just suspend the meeting just now till we get clarification on that? Thank you. Thank you. Commence with the meeting again. So can I call Amendment 23 in the name of Jeremy Balfour, already debated with Amendment 22. Jeremy Balfour, to move or not move?
Not move.
So the question is that... Sorry, that's... question is that Section 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay. I call Amendment 15 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 17 and 19. Can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 15 and speak to all amendments in the group?
These are three very minor amendments. Amendment 15 removes a redundant cross-reference. Amendment 17 and 19 modify two of the headings in the 2005 Act, which Oscar and the Charity Law Association respectively flagged as potentially confusing or inaccurate. My thanks to them for highlighting those points, and I move Amendment 15.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I now invite any other members if they wish to take part in the debate? Thank you. Can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 15?
Press, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Can I now call Amendment 16 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 14? Can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move formally?
Moved.
So the question is that Amendment 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I now call Amendment 17 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 15. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move formally?
Moved.
Thank you. Question is that Amendment 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I now call on Amendment 18 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary in a group of its own. Cabinet Secretary to move and speak to Amendment 18. Thank you.
Convener, the 2005 Act retained the concept of designated religious charities, or DRCs, which existed under preceding legislation. The rules in the 2005 Act recognised that many religious bodies operate effective self-regulatory mechanisms by having an internal organisation with supervisory and disciplinary functions and seek to avoid over-regulating such charities. However, the 2005 Act places restrictions on who OSCAR can share information with and for what purpose. In general, information can only be shared with public bodies and office holders for the purpose of enabling or assisting in the exercise of either OSCAR or the body's functions. As a DRC is not a public body and the information to be shared by OSCAR would not be for the exercise of its own function, it is not currently permitted. This bill does not seek to change that original policy intent of the 2005 Act. It seeks to address a practical issue identified by OSCAR and DRCs around the ability to share information. This amendment will enable OSCAR and the DRCs to share information if necessary for any purpose connecting with the exercise of OSCAR's functions or for the purpose of enabling or assisting the DRC to exercise any supervisory or disciplinary functions it holds in relation to its component elements. For example, where OSCAR receives information from an auditor or an independent examiner in relation to the accounts of a charity, which is a component part of a DRC, OSCAR is currently unable to share that information with the relevant DRC. That DRC, in turn, is then unable to fulfil its regulatory functions. This small amendment will allow DRCs to fully exercise their functions in respect of their component parts, thereby improving and enhancing the regulation of these charities. The amendment makes sure that current arrangements with DRCs can work properly and the original policy intent is not hampered by the inability to share information where necessary. I hope the committee will agree with the approach being taken here and will support Amendment 18, as the current position is that some charities are designated as DRCs. This bill needs to ensure that they can exercise their functions as intended by the 2005 Act, and I move Amendment 18.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I now invite members if they wish to contribute at this stage? Okay, thank you. So can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 18?
Press, Convener.
So the question is that Amendment 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
So I now call Amendment 19 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 15. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 20 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 14. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move formally?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that the schedule be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that sections 18 to 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
So that ends stage two considerations of the bill. And I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and her team for joining us this morning. Thank you. So can I just confirm that amendments for stage three can now be lodged with the legislation clerks? Thank you. Thanks, everyone. I formally close this meeting. Thank you.